So good morning, everyone, and welcome once again to another faculty proposition. Today's speaker is Sania Siddiqui. She has been teaching with us at Sushant School of Art and Architecture since 2019, sorry. And she's an architect from Pune University and completed her master's from Jamia and has worked in the industry for almost 5 years before she started teaching, and her first teaching experience was at Pune University, and after that she has been with us. She has worked at the national level ICMR project at the National Institute for Research in Environmental Health, Bhopal, and is an active committee member of the Indian Institute of Interior Designers, the Bhopal regional chapter, and where she hosted the Master Conclave series with nationally and internationally renowned architects, academics, and design professionals. So today, the topic of her proposition is social systems and urban structure of cities, synthesis of social process and spatial form. And we've worked on, you know, the Waqf as a special institution under this broad umbrella. So, Sania, would you like to take
yeah.
over?
Yeah, thank you, Radha. Good morning, all of you. So, I'll start my presentation.
Yes, thank you. Put myself on mute.
Okay, so is my presentation visible? Is my screen?
Yes, it is.
Okay. All right, so good morning, all of you. To begin with, I would like to mention that cities and the influences that shape them are a topic of endless fascination. So today in my presentation, I have also made an attempt to put together a few preliminary ideas. So the topic for today's presentation is social institutions and urban structure, Waqf in a pre-modern Islamic world. So I have organized my talk into three sections, where in the first part I've tried to look at the correlation between institutions and urban structure, or rather I would not say correlation, but the intersection, especially in the current and the recent trends where urban form and spatial structure are being looked at in conjunction. Then in the second section, I have made an attempt, I would say, to look at Waqf as an institution. And the third section is where I will require a lot of help from all of you, and where I've tried to develop a few arguments based on whatever study and whatever ideas I could put together. So we all know that cities are catalysts for economic growth, innovation, and employment. However, as per the UN World Social Report 2020, over the next three decades, all population growth is expected to occur in cities, raising implications for every aspect of sustainable development, and that includes inequalities as well. So this is the global scenario. In a study, Influence of Urban Forms on Social Sustainability of Indian Cities, that was conducted in 2012, it has been asserted that huge pressures of development and accelerated urbanization faced by Indian cities, the social dimension, that is a very important component of sustainable development, has largely been overlooked. And as a result, cities have abandoned their pre-industrial socio-physical form and have largely become a patchwork of the defensive city, the forgotten city, and the slum city. And that further emphasizes the increasing urban divide. Now, this was actually an attempt to look at the research that is available on social justice dimension of the city. And there is a sound body of research, but the few studies that I have put here, one is very important, where Susan Fanstein has worked to theorize the just city concept in her book, where she argues that urban planners need a normative theory of justice because their enthusiasm for social and built environment diversity has not produced alternatives to inequality under pro-growth regimes. And she also has brought up a model where she discusses equity, democracy, and diversity as the first order concerns for urban development. And however, she says that equity has to be of prime importance if the three are in a situation of conflict. David Harvey has emphasized issues of production as structural dynamics that characterize capitalist society and lead to unjust distribution of resources in space. He has described cities, our current cities, that are built in a way so as to invest, and they are basically vehicles of capital accumulation, and they are not cities to live in, or not livable cities. Then more recent works are by Laura Wohan and definitely Bob Lear in the field of space syntax, where exploration of influences of spatial configuration on social life are being studied. And social segregation is an important area where Laura Wohan has been publishing good work. Then Bob Hilliard and Hansen, through the social logic of space, investigate the social content of spatial patterning and establish relationship between society and space. Now, this is another more multifaceted way of looking at the intersection of society and space, where Louis Wirth, in his sociological definition of city, in his essay Urbanism as a Way of Life, he has mentioned that urban form impacting the mode of life may be approached empirically from three interrelated perspectives. So the first will be the physical structure, which comprises of the population base, technology, and ecological order of the city. The second is where urban form needs to be looked at as a set of attributes and ideas, where collective behavior comes into play, and which is subjected to mechanisms of social control. The third, which is, I think, where the scope of today's presentation also fits in, is where urban form is being looked at as a system of social organization involving a characteristic social structure as a series of social institutions and social relationships. Now, the image, the diagram on the right hand side is a figure that I've taken up from a study, that is social justice as a function of living environments, habitus, and capital forms, where the authors have tried to question the metric that could be used to actually measure social justice. And also they have tried to explore social outcomes of diverse spatial phenomena directing spatial policy that advances equality. So here it has been assumed, the hypothesis is that individuals' living environment determine their life chances, which further impacts the spatial equality. And in this particular model, Amartya Sen's human capabilities approach and Pierre Bourdieu's three capital forms, that is the economic, social, and cultural, have been employed to try to derive a metric for social justice. Now, this is a very comprehensive manual on urban morphology, which is by Victor Oliveira, where he has mentioned that urban morphology's impact can be studied on the society as a whole, or on the urban life, the collective life in cities, through three dimensions. That is the economic, the social, and the environmental dimension, where heritage tourism has a major impact when it comes to the economic dimension. Public health and social and spatial segregation are important elements of the social justice falling in the social dimension. And the environmental dimension has to deal with the climate change and energy. Now, this is a study, Elements of Urban Form, where urban form has been defined as a spatial configuration of fixed elements. And it also says that it doesn't just has physical aspects, but also has non-physical and intangible aspects. However, the physical aspects of urban form are majorly density, housing, building type, layout, land use, and transport and infrastructure. Now, the United Nations in the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development have also laid down three crucial dimensions, that is the social, the economic, and the environment, as the three dimensions of sustainability. However, if we see in this diagram, the interlinkages and the integrated nature of the sustainable development goals are crucial in the overall agenda, where the most important in the most important interface is between the social and economic, which talks about equity. Now, this is sustainable development goals, which we all are aware of. However, I'd like to bring your attention to sustainable development goal 11 and 16. So 11 talks about sustainable cities and communities, and sustainable development goal 16 emphasizes on peace, justice, and strong institutions. That is, it requires providing access to justice for all in order to create inclusive societies and building effective and accountable institutions at all levels. Now, looking at social institutions, so it was important for me also to understand as to what social institutions are. So social institutions are a subject of great sociological interest and research, but where and how it can be correlated with urban form and urban structure of cities, it is very important to understand social institution. So what is a social institution? So it is an idea that is embedded within a social structure and an organization, and it has roles that help in accomplishing the idea around which the social institution is formed. And along with roles, it has got relationship between those roles and different actors that act within that social institution. Now, the most important, most prominent social institutions shaping the society have been state or the government, education, religion, economics, and the family. Now, social institutions have a life of their own, and they reproduce themselves across time. So the proposition is to have a look at how these social institutions that have shaped the society can be seen in correlation with urban structure or urban form, and the impact that they can have on creating more equal cities. So that is the broader idea, and under which I'm talking about these ideas. Now, this is a research which was done by Nazir Sayed and Craig Bistel in their work on levels of congruence on urban form and institutional structure in different societies. So the figure that you see on the left hand side, it shows a comparative approach to explore the historical relationship between open space and urban activity in historically three distinct cultures. So a traditional European city, a traditional Middle Eastern city, and a traditional Chinese city have been compared. So this is one of the few researches that I got where institutions were being spoken about in terms of urban space and urban form. Another more contemporary research that I came across is by Peter J. Larkham, where he, in his work Institutions and Urban Form, the example of university, he focuses on the contribution of large institutions to urban landscapes and highlights the significant impact on these towns where these universities exist. Then the next work that I looked at is Role of Institutions in Urban Governance by Alison Bridges, where the author has mentioned that the historical institutional analysis is important to evaluate the structural change, which will further help in understanding and deepening the relation between local governance structure, private sector land interests, the market, and the civil society. So this slide was basically to put together the various reports and the various researches that I had got where institutions and urban form in some form or the other was being looked at. Now, another interesting research that I came across was by Michael Smith, where he is where in his work Form and Meaning in the Earliest Cities, he's trying to explore new approaches to ancient urban planning. And he says that there are numerous obstacles which remain for efforts to understand the nature of planning and their meaning in pre-industrial cities. So this shows that there are research gaps and not much work has been done as far as institutions and their urban interface are concerned. Now, moving to the next part, that is the Waqf. Now, these are certain initial influences that helped me in trying to, that drew my attention to the concept of Waqf in the Islamic world. So, the image on the left-hand side is a digital artwork by a friend. And that has, this is his idea of understanding and exemplifying equality before God. This is his expression where he's trying to express his understanding for equality before God. And actually, this is, if you look at this this image, this central image, the central part is the Kaaba in Makkah, and this is the circumambulation, the people that circumambulate around the sacred Kaaba. And for people who understand Arabic, this is Hajj. The Hajj in Arabic has been written. So this, when I looked at this image around a year back, it struck me that what could be the urban, what could be, or is there any urban form when we talk about egalitarian cities, egalitarian societies, or if egalitarian society and cities is a very theoretical concept, then even if we talk about in the realm of social justice, when we talk about equal cities and just cities, what is the urban form? So that was an idea which struck me when I looked at this particular artwork. Another influence that drew my attention to the concept of Waqf was the verse 92 of Surah 3 of the Quran that states, "Never will you attain the good reward until you spend in the way of God from that which you love and whatever you spend. Indeed, God is knowing of it." So this is one of the verses that also led to the introduction of the Waqf and the concept of the Waqf. So it was important to understand that Islam as a religion has a concept of maslaha, that is the Arabic version for public welfare, public interest, as a way of life. And we all are generally aware about the zakat, that is the most that is the obligatory charity, and the sadaqah, that is the non-obligatory charity. However, the third, that is Waqf, that was the institutional arrangement for wealth redistribution, and it was being used and is being used as a wealth redistribution mechanism, needs to be looked at. And it was under this that I started to look, started looking at Waqf. So Waqf actually means to take custody or detain. So it's the Arabic version of stopping or preventing. So Waqf by Abru Boyer in her book, A Social History of Ottoman Istanbul, describes Waqf as the cradle to grave institution, where she says that a man could be born in the Waqf house, could sleep in the Waqf cradle, eat and drink in Waqf from the Waqf provisions, read in Waqf libraries, teach in Waqf schools, draw his or her wages from the Waqf administration, die in a Waqf coffin and be buried in a Waqf graveyard. So this is just to start off with the impact that Waqf had on the Muslim societies. Now these are some of the areas where the Waqf has had a strong impact, that is religious construction, religious and public construction, education and the scientific movement, healthcare, welfare, infrastructure projects, and employment. So if we look at the definition of Waqf, it is a continuous charitable act for the sake of God. And the two important objectives, before we get into the structure of how the Waqf works, it is important to understand that the person who endows his property served as, so the objective or his motivation was perpetual reward in the hereafter. And ultimately, the endowments contributed to the socio-economic development of the society in general and the underprivileged in particular. So Waqf started off it started functioning under the Sharia or the Islamic law from the 3rd century. However, it has been there, or the first Waqf, for example, if you look at the image on the left, Masjid al-Quba in Medina, this was the first Waqf, and it was done by the Prophet himself, that is in 622 CE. Now, to understand the WAF, it is important that there has to be an individual or a group of individuals known as the Waqif who decide to endow their property, that is the WAF, and which has to be a revenue generating property, because this particular the act of WAF has to be, it is in perpetuity and it is continuous. Therefore, the property needs to be revenue generating. Then there is a beneficiary or a set of beneficiaries who will be supported by these individuals, and these beneficiaries are known as alaihim, and they are going to be funded from the revenue that is generated by the waqf property. Now, in order to administer the waqf, there is mutawalli, who is basically the waqf administrator and is chosen by the waqif or the endower. There is a judge or the qazi to settle disputes. Now, the waqf has been reported to be of three types. One was the public waqf or the waqf khairi, which largely dealt with construction of mosques and religious structures, and also healthcare and education were important parts of the public waqf. Then was the private or the family waqf and the mixed waqf. So basically, this distinction was based on the nature of the beneficiary. So if it was from the family, then it was a private or a family waqf. But eventually, when the descendants of the beneficiaries would die under those conditions, the private waqf would also get transferred to the public waqf or for the society at large. And the third was a mixed waqf, where the beneficiaries could be both from the public or the private, or the individual's family. Now, three important sources from where the I would say these are the historical records, the waqfiyas or the waqf deeds that were established when the waqf foundations were laid down, and they had each and every detail about the beneficiary, the nature of the waqf property that was being endowed, the maintenance, repair, provisions, and it also included all the information for the salaries and for the upkeep of the entire waqf. Then historical chronicles, which were more informal in nature, and they are also very important in informing about the various works that have survived across centuries. The third is the hujja. So this was basically in the Ottoman times, which spoke about which actually recorded all the changes that would keep happening in the waqf property. It was to understand the waqf, I felt it was very important for me to understand the Islamic timeline, because the waqf is as old as the history of Islam itself in the world, and therefore it was very important to understand these different phases that occurred. So first, if you see here, this is when Islam came as a religion, and this was the birth of the caliphate. And this is also a time when the Sufi movement had started to come up. So we, as I showed you in the last slide, the first waqf was a mosque which was endowed by the Prophet himself. Then this particular phase shows when the caliphate started to get fragmented into sultanates. However, this was a time when the institutionalization of waqf started to become stronger, and it developed, and it was it kind of took its proper form by the end of the 8th century. Now this is the time again when the three contemporary Mughal empires, that is the Ottoman dynasty, the Mughal dynasty in India, and the Safavid dynasty in Persia in the 17th century, and they also have important waqfs, and important research has also been done on the waqf endowments that were done and their impact on the cities. Now this particular part of the timeline shows where the waqf had started to fragment, or it had started losing its institutional importance, especially during the colonial and the post-colonial government. Now, these are a few slides where I've tried to put in research done by people where WAQF has been projected as a poverty reduction institution. So, Zuki has mentioned that a lot of humanitarian projects, such as building houses for the needy, developing springs for public water consumption, building bridges, financing orphanages and old age homes, as well as financing marriages for the young people in need was done through the WAQF. Then significant social role that WAQF played in supporting various charitable needs of the city, especially providing food for the poor and drinking water to neighborhoods. The image on the right shows Galata Bridge in Istanbul, where distribution of clothing and food is being done under WAQF provisions. Now, this on the left is Kalaoun Complex in Cairo, which is a complex established by Sultan Al Masud. And so this is basically a complex where hospital, madrasas, and other institutions of importance were brought together within this Kalaoun complex. Again, healthcare was an important area, important sector where the WAQF contributed, and a number of hospitals were built during this period. Now, this shows WAQF as service providing institutions. Apart from healthcare, education and developing educational institutions was another sector where WAQF contributed. So the image shows Al-Azhar University in Cairo, which is one of the earliest and the oldest existing universities in the world. That was as well a WAQF. Now, these are a few people who have mentioned, for example, WAQF was extensive in the city and it was a significant institution for the support of religious structures as well as social services of the city. This is talking in particular about Ottoman Aleppo. Then WAQF was one of the principal institutions that enabled cities and urban societies to function effectively during the Muslim period. Les Grand's works in 1979 is a very important work which also emphasizes the role of WAQF foundations in promoting water fountains that were known as sabils and public baths, hammams. So WAQF played, according to Raymond Abe, WAQF played an important critical role in promoting the establishment of collective housing in Cairo, and that ultimately led to greater density of population. So we can see that almost everything that had to do with the society was being dealt through the WAQF. Now, this slide shows a very important typology that came up during the time of Ottomans. And this is an image which shows the kulliye complexes. So if you see on the left, this image, this map shows historical peninsula of Istanbul. And these are all the kulliye complexes that I have marked. So these kulliye complexes were actually a complex where everything that was related to the society, for example, the hospital, a medical school, different madrasas that are religious schools, then a public kitchen where not just the WAQF employers would be catered to, but also the people in need, and the underprivileged section could come and have their meals. Then hospice, that was a place, that was a house or a home for the terminally ill. Then basic public facilities like the fountain, the toilets. Definitely the mosque was the most important and the most, it formed the cultural center as far as the kulliyes were concerned. And architecturally, this was the most magnificent, whereas the others they acted more as edifices to this entire complex. And this particular image shows how different kulliyes existed. So we can see one here. This is the Suleymaniye kulliye, the most famous kulliye of the 16th century. And if you can see here, this is the other one. So this is how these kulliyes helped in shaping the urban landscape of Istanbul. And they were strategically placed. Now, WAQF and how it contributed in the economics of the society. So, Hayashi K. in his work in 1994 states that WAQF property formed larger part of urban commercial facilities and engaged merchants and artisans within the framework of WAQF system, and directly these were all related to the urban economic activity. Then in another work, that is Empires and Emporia, which is done by Dale SF, he states and brings attention to the association between empires and commercial institutions. So he largely speaks about the three empires, the three contemporary Muslim empires in the 17th century, where they had a very strong relation with the commercial institutions. And according to him, he states that it was this particular symbiotic relationship was possible only because of the Waqf being in place. Now, this is a figure where it shows that how Waqf would draw funds from by establishing shops, bazaar and caravanserais, that is the commercial institutions, were established by the Waqf, and the revenue was generated from these commercial institutions, which was further fed in to the institutions that were established for public use. For example, the mosques, the different schools, public baths, and other religious institutions such as the madrasas. And this is how these commercial institutions were built nearby these complexes that started to come up. And this is how the mosques did not did not remain cultural centers, but also evolved as important commercial centers. Now, there is a very important relationship between the Sufi or the Dervish institution and the Waqf. So Dervishes, we are more familiar with the term Sufi. Dervishes was a similar term which was used in the Turkish cities or across the Ottoman Empire. So Waqf and Zaviyye were inseparable institutions. Now, Zaviyyes were lodging houses for specific sheikhs or the spiritual instructors under the dervish system that started to come up. And every zaviyya accompanied a waqf which supplied necessary economic fiscal revenue for the dervishes living within these zaviyyas. And Yildirim R also states that these zaviyyas they evolved as important economic, social and cultural centers, dominating the whole process of Ottoman conquest and expansion. So we can see that waqf also had a political impact as well. So the image on the left shows a zaviyya in Tunis, and another version of the zaviyya was the khanqa, that was basically the Sufi convents. And this is an example from the medieval Islamic Cairo, where rapid expansion had started to happen of the Sufi covenants, and these were all managed on the basis of the Waqf documents. So everything was basically detailed out in the Waqf documents about the zaviyyas and the khanqas. Now, this is one of the works done by Ghazale in her book Held in Trust, Waqf in the Islamic World, where the author has tried to revive a historical commercial center in Adana, one of the cities in Turkey, where on the left you can see this is the current condition of the historical commercial center. And with the help of the Waqf or the Waqf document and the Waqf deeds, there are certain superimpositions that have been done on this particular existing layout. And the restitution of the historical commercial center has been finally done, because the work deeds have detailed information about what existed, and also the maintenance. Along with the maintenance, there are architectural specifications and layouts and site analysis available within the work deeds that were used for the restitution of this commercial center. Now, this is again a very small attempt to kind of understand the scholarship that is available on Waqf in the Islamic World, as it is a huge area of research. However, the scholars have divided the Islamic region, the Islamic world that existed in the pre-modern world into different regions. So the Maghrib and the Andalus, that is basically the Iberian Peninsula and the current Spain. So these particular cities, for example, Granada, Fez, Casablanca, Marrakesh, and Algiers, these are the areas, these are the cities where the initial Waqf endowment studies had started to take place. Now, to give a broad overview, till the 1960s, the concept of Islamic city has been debated, and that was a time when the idea of Islamic city was starting being criticized as to because looking at the geographical extent and also in time, looking at time and place, the Islamic city model that was given largely by the French scholars did not fit in. And therefore, this was a time when scholars started to look at the influence, the extent of the influence of Islam as a religion on urban structures and society. Now, the second region, that is the Mashriq, Egypt and Syria, Damascus, Jerusalem, Cairo and Aleppo had established waqfs, and a large part of the waqf study has been done in these cities. Now, this is another important region, that is Iraq and Iran, that is Persia and the olden days. So again, Baghdad, Kufa, Basra, these are some of the cities where the initial waqf studies started to take place. However, there are certain gaps also. So one of them is that waqf endowments in the Iranian world began to grow remarkably in number in the 12th and 13th centuries. However, the logic and the reasoning to that question has not yet been worked upon. Then another important region to look into the waqf study is Turkey and the Anatolian cities majorly. So a lot of work has already been done as far as Istanbul is concerned, but now the recent focus has shifted to social and physical structure of middle-sized Anatolian cities and role of the waqf in this particular area. Another important study is by G. Baer, where he talks about women and waqf, and he states that 36.8% of all waqf founders were women, and that many of those waqf were of modest scale. Now, in a very important study, that is by Lewin R.V., waqf is a determining, he states that waqf is a determining factor in the growth and structure of Muslim cities, and he has explained and tried to establish this through the example of Ottoman Damascus. So far, whatever geographical regions I made a mention about, there have been a lot of quantitative studies as far as the waqfs are concerned, where the waqf deeds are generally employed to understand so they were basically quantitative studies. However, qualitative studies have still not been looked into. So this is some of the gaps that I could find out from the different research that I was looking into, and also from Islamic Urban Studies Historical Review and Perspectives, that is a project which was carried out by Japan on urbanism in Islam. So they state that the temporal and spatial dimensions of waqf, the geographical and historical realities need to be examined. And Matt Chesney, who has done a lot of work in the Central Asian studies, says that waqf is an Islamic institution made accessible to the historian by its documentary record, but to appreciate fully the way it is woven into the fabric of human society and to assess its place in the achievements of Muslim communities, the documentary record is only a beginning. And that is where the temporal and spatial dimensions of the waqf come into the picture. Then, when thinking of the city as a point of intersection of people and goods, the role of the waqf system is extremely important, and study of waqf properties in relation to the distinctive spatial structure of cities is something that is still needs a lot of attention. Then, if city has to be looked as an association, use of waqf institution to understand the internal criteria of social groups and individuals and group behavior, it is important to inquire into the role of social networks that gave structure and coherence to the urban society. This is one of the important studies that has been done by S. Farooqi. Now, other studies also state that waqf study requires a multifaceted approach, where identity of the waqf founder or the beneficiaries needs to be done, and also change in social in their social and economic identity needs to be studied. Then the nature of property endowed, conditions of access to the waqf revenue. Then there were across time there were new class of donors that started to come up. So what were their motives? Then principles regulating creation and management, the types of services that were being provided by WAFs, the activities that coalesced around these WAFs, and the changes that the institution underwent, because it has been reported not to be a stagnant institution, and it did undergo a lot of changes depending on the needs and the wishes of the people who were working very closely with the WAF. So again, time and place are important dimensions when we look at these institutions, or WAF in particular. Then impact they had on the organization of urban space is something still that needs to be looked into. Now, whatever I spoke about is the scholarship that has been done on WAF and how it evolved in the past. Now, what is the status of WAF in the present context? And because WAF is a very important and one of the largest Islamic endowments in the entire world in India, I thought that it would be good to look at the present Indian context. So we all know that it has been reported that in the 13th century, the WAF had started, and the Muslim sultans had been funding the Awqaf, that is the plural for the Waqf. And Hussein and Rashid said that with Mughal Empire in the 16th century, the scale and magnitude grew to unprecedented levels. Then the Waqf gradually started to fragment during the British colonial rule. However, in 1954, the Waqf Act was put in place, which was further amended in 95 and then 2013. And currently we have a central WAF council that is under the Ministry of Minorities Affairs, Government of India, where we have state WAF boards, which act as statutory bodies under the WAF Act. Now it has been estimated by Sachar Committee that total value of WAF properties, if we look at the Indian scenario, is 5 lakh assets in number. And the area that these properties cover is 6 lakh acres. And it was reported that the market value of these properties were more than 60 billion Indian rupees. And the revenue that could have been generated if these properties were being managed in a better way, it would have been 1200 billion Indian rupees per annum. So according to National Institute of Labor Economics Research and Development, Delhi, WAF properties have been reported to be national resources, and the revenues that could be generated every year are actually somewhere being lost. Now, generally the revenue that should come out of the WAF needs to be distributed in these particular areas, that is the welfare, education, employment, equity, and participatory role. Now, there are definitely certain challenges. And these challenges, these are not just that the Indian WAFs are facing. These challenges are almost everywhere in the world, especially in countries such as Malaysia, Indonesia, which were ruled by which had a colonial rule, and now they are under more of a secular setup. So ineffective administration and management is one of the challenge. Then there is no development of the WAF properties, despite a comprehensive legal framework. Then there is large-scale encroachment of the WAF properties. And despite the SWBs or the state WAF boards being in place, the basic surveys are yet to be completed. Inadequate records are available as far as the digital platform are concerned. And WAMSI, that is a computerized record keeping, is a good initiative as far as the WAF digital records are concerned, but it needs a lot of work. Then another very important area that needs a lot of attention is the mismanagement and the negligence or lack of transparency as far as the role of mutawallis is concerned. So mutawallis have played a historic role in the administration of the WAF, and a lot of mismanagement has been reported from the part of the mutawallis, which needs to be looked into. And again, funds is another issue with the state WAF boards. Now, coming to some of the questions. So this is the last slide. Some of the questions that could be looked into with whatever ideas I have tried to put together. Now, these are certain areas that I've tried to touch upon. For example, social justice, social equity, then looking into institutions and their restructuring, rearrangement, their impact on urban policy, then definitely the impact that all of this has on the urban form. And also one important thing that came up was like how religion as an institution has influenced the urban form. And this is not just to do with the Waqf, but also across civilization, we have had institutions in place that have definitely had a very strong impact on the urban form. So these are some of the questions that I would just like to quickly mention. So like how understanding social institutions such as the Waqf that played a role in shaping the society contribute to the knowledge base of engaging in the redesigning of the institutions in contemporary times, how gaps between traditional and modern paradigms be bridged, and how can a balance between local processes and global structure be achieved to create socially sustainable cities, and also looking at institutions that exhibited impact on the built form and society across civilizations, can we decode parameters that can help in shaping urban form of cities which are more equal. So I think this was from me. I mean, this was from my end. However, before I conclude, I would like to make a mention of a professor, Michael Stopper from the London School of Economics, where in his book, Keys to the City, he talks about social justice and creating equal cities. And he argues that we need to abandon the need for perfection and instead look for a social choice process. And this social choice process is nothing but where, as researchers, as academics, we try and develop information to have a more enriching social choice debate. And in his words, we have messy and noisy issues as far as cities are concerned. And therefore, we need to give loud, messy and noisy solutions as well. So thank you. Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Sania. Very, very detailed. And, you know, for initial research, I must say that's a lot of work already done. I'd like to open it up to questions now from our audience, faculty members, guests who've joined in. You could also type in your queries in the chat box, or you could just, you know, say it yourself. Just.
Well, that was a lot to take in, Sania. Oof, that was so detailed.
Thank you, sir.
It's difficult to come up with a question. It's so much hitting you.
Yeah, a lot of information to assimilate and come back. Parul, would you like to?
I found that, you know, the kind of impacts that you were looking at in the last slide, that, you know, the possible things that you can look at and look at the influence and the impacts and influences in the present day are certainly, I think, valid areas to further look into. So I have these two points that I wanted to ask, which actually come from actually one main point, which is it that you're looking at you know, Waqf as a national entity, or are we looking at the state? Because you of course had that hierarchy in place, but the dynamics of the central Waqf board versus the state Waqf boards is quite different. And at the same time, you know, particularly states like Haryana, it's extremely difficult, you know, because like the issues that you mentioned, which are lack of transparency, and, you know, all of these things are blatantly so in the case of Haryana. So in fact, I had a few years ago when I was speaking to this Maulana about the Waqf and its historical repercussions and all, and he was very clearly and candidly talking about how you know, the idea of the Waqf, when it was the centralized kind of you know, Waqf, and then before it got decentralized in the state levels, it was much more effective, and it was much more you know, transparent and effective, because of the management was very effective, because typically you had you know, IAS cadre people who were involved, and then when it sort of decentralized and got into the state level, then that, you know, doesn't happen anymore. And so hence, obviously, the management is very poor. So there are these kind of dimensions, of course, which become important at the state level versus at the national Wakf Board level. So maybe, I mean, I don't know if you like to situate yourself in, you know, one of the states, or whether you wanted to look at the comparison between states and this or whatever, you know, as you go forward in your research. The second is a personal question, because recently, you know, because we were involved in this Adab Bazaar project, and we went to the Jami Masjid, and, you know, had we were just walking around in the area, Preetam and I, Preetam from design school and me, and there is this Ghamandan Sarai gateway, which is there just near the Command Sarai, near the Jami Masjid. And so we were talking to this particular guy who was a caretaker, and he said that now the Ghamandan Sarai has been sold, so obviously now it's going to be broken down and it's going to be converted into whatever shops or whatever it may be. So just this query that, you know, this, of course, there is this very inseparable connection of revenue generation and Wakf. So I fundamentally find this a little problematic that, you know, what about the ones that get abandoned then? What about the ones that don't generate revenue? And how can we look at models which, you know, redefine the role of Wakf in some way, or you know, whatever. So, you know, because there are lots of properties that I came across in my study also, which had all kinds of funny arrangements, you know, either somebody had taken over, encroached the property, and Wakf Board was like, okay, just whatever is happening, we don't care. Or there was a little bit of petty revenue generation by shops being inserted, and then the shops are inserted insensitively, because the ultimate goal is only revenue generation then. So sometimes you see the sensitivity, sometimes you don't see the sensitivity towards the built form when these interventions, because ultimately if we're only talking about revenue generation, then, you know, I know that there are diktats and there are, you know, rules and regulations with respect to, you cannot demolish, you cannot, you know, all of that. But still, you know, so I've seen all of these processes in play, all kinds of varying processes in play. So, yeah, so I was just curious to understand, is it sellable, the Wakf property? Because I don't know that.
No, ma'am. Whatever little understanding I've gained so far, so these properties are for like, you know, they have to be, once they are put under Wakf, they are always, they belong to society. So they are not saleable, but definitely, so there are studies, ma'am, like some of the studies that I came across that are speaking about the changing structure of the Wakf. So It is not that Wakf is a stagnant institution, but again, like you mentioned, there's a lot of mismanagement. So I think revitalizing the role of the Wakf and restructuring the entire institution may be one of the ways of how to look into these specific problems. But it is doable for sure. I mean, this is what I could gauge from the different studies that people are doing across the world in regards to Wakf.
Sure. Thanks, Anna. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. That was really helpful.
Hi, Sanya. Good morning. Thank you. That was eye-opening. I had no idea the Wakf Board had an influence that was so large. And I mean, I'm coming from the Indian perspective. I mean, being a secular nation that we are, I question the influence that you're looking at. I mean, why would you perpetuate the Wakf Board having an influence in urban form? I mean, should we not be, breaking down the boundaries? I'm talking secularly. By doing what you are studying, aren't we going to reinforce those boundaries? So, rather than it being this insular kind of department, I just worry a little about that. In India, I understand in the Ottoman and, you know, in those areas where it's predominantly one culture, one history. Here, I just worry about that, and I'd love to know your thoughts. And I mean, this is a perpetual discussion that will never end. But I understand why you want to look at it, but I question it in our
context.
Yeah, context.
So ma'am, I don't think I will be able to answer your question right now. However, definitely this is a question that has been troubling me also, as to, like, you know, how does this the work fits into the secular structure of our country. And so one way of how I look at it is that these works have been existing, and, you know, like, they are still, they continue to exist. And we as urban planners and architects, we do, you know, we do come across these work properties. So so I felt that one way, I mean, I'm just being very candid about it. One way of looking at it could be that if the revenue that is supposed to get generated from these works is achieved, then that will also act as a national resource and would actually, you know, to some extent lessen the burden of the economy, of the national economy, because at least one minority, and that too the you know, like, Muslims form the major, they are the biggest minority in the country, they can be catered to, at least through the waqf that is anyway existing. So this was one of the things that came to my mind, but I definitely need to look into this, in particularly when we talk about the Indian context.
Yeah, thanks.
Thank you.
Follow up to that, to Ekta's point, but I mean, differently, maybe I was wondering whether it can be, you could also look at how this has worked in other countries. You've mentioned Ottoman, because they also underwent a series of historical, yes, changes with respect to, you know, the dominance of one culture, and, you know, they have officially changed their national religion, as it were,
true.
You know, over the centuries. And how did the waqf board across those different, you know, across those timelines actually change, and, you know, what was their relationship to the state, as it were, under these different changing circumstances, and did it become maybe just something to look at?
I think that is a very important point. Thanks, Radha. I will definitely look into that. That should be helpful.
Well, one definition of a secular country is that it incorporates all these different ways of living, including waqf boards and whatever other institutions there are from other religions. So the question really, I think, would be really, how does everybody work harmoniously rather than at odds?
I think, Mark, I really appreciate your point, because I think the word secular has to be really understood the way it was defined. It doesn't mean complete absence of any kind of, you know, religious thought. So I think this, what Mark is saying, is absolutely correct. And in that sense, I think the topic that Sanya has taken is of extreme importance. I would suggest, Sanya, that you forget your first part.
Yes, sir.
Because your second part is very important, and I think it is also extremely, you know, solid in terms of how you would go further. You know, because it is extremely important for us also to somehow understand how the entire idea of waqf could be sort of evolving and, you know, sort of reinterpreted in current society. I don't think you will be able to get into the nitty-gritties of how waqf, you know, sort of operates. It's very difficult, you see, because I have really studied, you know, in NID, I was doing a liberal arts elective, and they wanted me to talk about history of the city to the students of NID. I had roughly 45 students registered for this elective, because NID students never went out of their campus, you know, and they hardly knew what the old city was. So it was a great opportunity to direct the students to know the city through institutions of the city. And Waqf was one very important institution I had picked up, because Ahmedabad has a very strong Waqf board. And you know, the kind of association within each family that the students wanted to really understand came out through understanding these institutions. You know, I had picked up 7 institutions of the city which were established during different times of 600 years history. So Waqf, you know, when it came, we came up with a huge, you know, essay from these 7 students who really worked on Waqf. And it was very revealing. Then my association with Waqf here was with the chief of the Waqf here in Ahmedabad, while I was working on the dossier. Because Ahmedabad is the only city perhaps in the country which has 28 Islamic monuments within the small area of the city. Now, it was very important to understand how the entire settlement pattern developed because of the proximity to the mosque and the temples, you know, which were completely in unison. And there was a tremendous, you know, it was very interesting. There were Christian monuments in the old city, Jewish monuments in the old city, Hindu temples, Jain temples, and mosques. And they were all in equal numbers. So I think the idea of you know, a settlement, you know, established around a place of worship is something which is extremely important in the city of Ahmedabad, if you want to study the settlement pattern of the city. So this is something which is very important. When you talk of urban morphology, I think it is something, you know, which is a concept which Konzen developed, you know. And this is something which is entirely based on the geography of the city. You see, like the social, you know, conditions establish the patterns of association of settlement. The geography also affects the settlement patterns, you see, because I think one has to really understand the geography of the city in order to understand the settlement pattern. So morphology is something, you know, which is more associated with geography. And I think you should study Konzen more than anyone else.
Sure, sir.
About Islamic patterns, about Islamic structuring of built environment, I think you should really look up, you know, which I sort of also looked up when I was doing the dossier, an Egyptian scholar called, his name is Hisham Mortada. And he is a great scholar who has worked, you know, from in many Islamic countries as well as in India. Then he was a kind of professor at the Arizona State University. And now he is with Abdulaziz, you know, University in Jeddah. His work on settlement, he's an architect, but he's a professor. His work on Islamic traditional urban patterns is excellent. I think you should really refer to this author.
Sure,
you know,
sir.
Because I think more and more, I think you should really depend on Islamic scholars interpreting, you know, these institutions. So I would really suggest, because I really like your, in your way forward, your third point. You know, I mean, I don't have the slide here, but I think that third point which you have mentioned is the key of your study. And I think it is very important for you to do this study, because these kind of studies are done rarely. You know, and I was very fortunate because I come from a city, you know, where I have lived, you know, with this community. You know, there was such a tremendous integration in Junagadh, for example. I mean, if you really want to understand what secular meant, I think you have to really experience this yourself. You know, the mutual admiration, mutual respect for each other's, you know, beliefs. Because when it comes to religion, these beliefs are private. But it only teaches you how to be human. And that component of humanity has to really be public. So I think this is a very interesting subject. I liked your second part. I really failed to understand your first part, because I think with us, there is a kind of, you know, fascination of the work done in West. And we are trying to use those models to apply to our traditional societies, you know, which is completely irrelevant. We have to find our own analytical models from our culture. And I think second part really leads you to that. And your way forward is something which will really lead you to understand further. So this is what I would like to say. Radha, I'm sorry I've taken a lot of time.
No, sir, I think that was extremely helpful. Extremely helpful. Thank you so much, sir. Sir, I'll definitely get back to you in future as well.
No, sure. Anytime, because I would really like to also show you our work here, you know, that
yes,
we have
sir.
Done.
Yes,
and,
sir.
You know, that Waqf, the entire operation of Waqf in Ahmedabad is something which you should really understand, because it is extremely, it is strong. They have willingness to improve, and they have tremendous affinity to their own traditions, which makes a society very strong, I think. One has to really see that.
Yes, sir.
Thank you so much, sir. Yeah, thank you so much, Professor Vasava. And yeah, always a pleasure to hear you and to take your inputs. So, any other questions? I know we are running, we are over 10 a.m. Yeah, Paru, please.
So just a very quick comment here that since we're talking about secularity and all of that, I think the important question here is custodianship, I would say, because obviously Waqf does that. I mean, brings the idea of custodianship, and that idea of custodianship is, and continuity and custodianship and ownership is something that makes or breaks, you know, the urban form in some ways. And, you know, the linkages and the influences and the decision making is all hence connected in that sense. And you know, of course, there are, just like, you know, Professor Vasavra also mentioned, so even in, you know, around us, we see that on one end we have Waqf as an institution, and similarly we have other institutions which are temple trusts and, you know, all kinds of, you know, religious oriented trusts, yes, which are there related to all religions. So it's not an exception. It is common across all religions that we have such institutional frameworks, which may differ in their mechanisms, their organizational systems, but of course they exist. So the only thing I wanted to again, you know, bring out, you know, because I obviously can refer to the work that I've been doing in the area of Haryana and Delhi and all. So again, you know, connecting with the what Professor Vasavra mentioned in terms of the very strong kind of a vibrant Waqf board in Ahmedabad, like we see in Gujarat. And then we look at, you know, this question of custodianship having completely been cut down, I would say, or influenced in a strong way because of the impact of the partition in Delhi, Haryana and Punjab. So this whole belt and how this custodianship has been sort of, it's there, but it's weakened, it's sort of disempowered in certain ways. So I think that is very interesting to see. I mean, I don't know whether you will get into that dimension at all, but just wanted to mention that it's interesting to see how, you know, these kind of political dimensions and events and historical, you know, phenomena have played such an important role in empowering or disempowering, you know, this idea of custodianship that the Waqf brings, and hence the influence on the urban form and community and their connections and the whole idea of the Waqf as a healthy institution or not being, or being a weekend kind of a thing. That's just something that I wanted to.
Sure, ma'am. No, I noted that. Thank you so much.
No, Parul, that is really true, because I think what is needed is some kind of a background of how Waqfs function, you know. Huh. How Waqfs are ideally supposed to function, how they function in today's context,
yes,
and how, you know, they sort of need, you know, some kind of, you know, contemporary outlook. You know, so these, what you're mentioning is very true.
Thank you.
So I think this is something, you know, which is missing in your subject, because right now you have simply described the entire, you know, phenomena of Wakaf. You know, but I think you have to come down to the present context and pick up a Wakaf board, maybe in Haryana or Delhi or wherever, and then cross compare, you know, as to how they function in India in general, in important cities. For example, if you go to places like Bidar or Hyderabad, you know, you will find in Bahamani, you know, Bahamani Sultanate was very, very, you know, sort of orthodox, you know. And they had a very, very deep control over the society. So there you see the whole functioning even today is very different. Ahmedabad is also to a certain extent, it is like that, you see. Our whole effort was to bring them together, open them, you know, but I think there is always a resistance, you know. So I think you should really make a cross contextual study within India, which I think will give you a very good basis, you know, for your study. No, I think, Parul, your point is well taken.
Thank you. Sure, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Any other questions? Sanya, do you have any thing that you want to...
I think there's something from Tapasya in the chat box, Radha.
Sorry, yes, I should be reading. Tapasya has written, just speculating as a marginally informed audience in the subject, if we can see any parallel systems in other communities, religion, social structures, just to diversify the idea of religious institutions for the upliftment of communities and parishes. So I think
ma'am, that's a very valid point. And like I mentioned on the last slide, that right now I've just looked into Waqf as one institution, but my interest is to look at institutions that have, you know, that have been there. For example, like, you know, sir and Paul ma'am also mentioned that these settlements, they had a very strong connection with the religious institutions. So I think the idea is to look at the larger, you know, the impact that these institutions across time have had on the urban structure or the way our cities have functioned. So that is, and I think that is important also, because there is not just one way of doing something that is right. We need to take the best from everything that is available to us. So that's a well taken point for sure.
And also a comment by Kankan. She's saying it's very detailed and relates to her subject, to her interest area, which is dignified livability in urban areas. So she thanks you. Maybe you and Kankan could have a talk.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, thanks, Kankan. I think we can wrap up for today. Thank you so much for your enthusiastic participation, and thank you, Sanya, for presenting so much material on an area that is little known, little discussed, or in smaller pockets. Thank you so much, Professor Vasavra. As always, pleasure to have you.
And it's a pleasure. It's pleasure for me, and I think it is wonderful. Thank you. This activity is really good.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Yes, it's really taken off in the online platform. Thank you, sir, for your encouragement.
No, this is very useful. Very useful.
I think, Sobhya, we could probably stop recording. And we have another proposition, the last one for this semester. That's in 2 weeks.